everyone. Welcome to this morning's session, Intelligent Threat Intel Lead Framework. We have Filip Stojkovski, Threat Intel Manager from Adobe, speaking to us. And just a quick note that the slides have been posted already online, so feel free to look online or after the presentation. Thanks.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. So, as you mentioned, I'll share more details about the Threat Intel framework, which is helping you lead threat intelligence. So just to get started and to give you an idea through what we will go through today, we will start with the cyber threat intelligence pain points, or what are the current problems that we have with cyber threat intelligence. And then we will go through the thing how we can effectively and efficiently resolve them. The idea is to use the lead framework to increase the value of the threat intelligence and make sense of the threat intelligence data. To start with approaching the threat intelligence pain points. So here I'm using the survey from SIEMs. This is the survey from SIEMs 2019. The latest one has been published last week, but the results are not so different. Still, they're proving the same point. So I'm starting with the requirements. First thing is you can see that 70% of the organizations, they have no clear requirements of for threat intelligence. What that means in reality means that threat intelligence has been created to serve ad hoc purpose. That means that it has been used for solving specific incident, helping the SOC with some analysis, but on the long run, it won't work. Because if we don't have clear requirements, that means that we cannot provide clear value or build threat intelligence metrics. The second one is the data, which is really concerning, because threat intelligence is all about data. I mean, we know how good is our threat intelligence based on the threat intel data that we have. Here we have the survey showing how satisfied we are with the cyber threat intelligence. Going a little lower on the table, you can see the one that I would say it's starting to be concerning is the location-based visibility. That means that we don't know exactly how relevant is the threat intelligence data for us. Going forward is really concerning because we don't know how to handle data retention. That means that we have too much data. If we are going like 6-7 years ago, when all the threat intelligence things started and it became a buzzword, everyone was like, we don't have enough data. So all the vendors, they started selling and doing a lot of marketing on what is the right threat intel data for you. But nowadays, it's a little different. Now we have too much data, and we don't know exactly what we should do them. We should do with it. The thing is that the threat intelligence is becoming like handling big data, which is sort of complicated. And the last one is the machine learning. So machine learning can help us a lot with big data, but the thing is that we have no clear approach how to use machine learning. So considering all of this, and we can summarize it in two big issues that we have. First, threat intelligence, it's not something essential for our organization. And the second, we have the data problem. Going into more details for the non-essential problem. Here I'm using the sliding scale for cybersecurity, right by SIEMs. For those that they're seeing it for the first time, it's showing how hard it is to implement specific security control. On the blue side, you'll see the architecture, which is way easier to implement. And on the right side, it's with the red, is what it's like offense. It's pen testing. It's a little harder to implement. I'll use it a little differently than what it's hard or easy to implement. I'll say this is the list of security controls that your executive has. And they're starting to see what it's actually important, what it must have. We start with architecture. We cannot go without it because we need to have security control architecture in place. Passive defense, same thing. active defense is the same thing. Even the offensive side, now it's a must-have thing. If you're going through an audit or you want to get some certification for your organization, doing a pen testing, it's a must-have thing. You cannot go without it. Where sad is that threat intelligence is something nice to have. To make things worse, we have the value and the cost. So this is where we stand. The value of threat intelligence is pretty small, but the cost is pretty high. So we have a lot of work to do. The thing is that we need to increase the value and reduce the cost so we can make threat intelligence program valuable. On the threat intelligence data, if someone is asking me to put threat intelligence state today in one picture, this is what I pick, because it's sort of a big mess. On one side, we have all the data coming, all the threat intelligence feeds that we have. The pole in the middle holding everything, it's your threat intelligence platform or that you need to handle. And on the other side, we have all the stakeholders and where we should send the threat intelligence data and make use of it. So I'd say it's a tough job. So considering these two really big problems, we came up with an idea to build a framework that it will show how to solve these two really big problems for threat intelligence. And on the other side, we will help others as well to make threat intelligence valuable for their organization. So the first step that we took it was solving these big problems needed to be some sort of structured. So the structure that we decided on, it's taking like four simple steps, starting with what is relevant. So before doing threat intelligence, or even if you have running threat intelligence program, to understand if you're doing it right, first you need to understand what is relevant for you, so to find the relevant data. Going forward, once we have all the data in one place, let's say threat intelligence platform, database, repository, we need to make it efficient, because making it efficient will help us understand what we have, what is important for us, and we can deliver it to all the stakeholders that we have. Analyst-driven. This is an interesting one. It's all about feedback. It's actually the human element in all this framework. Threat intelligence is all about sharing and getting the feedback on what you have done. If we don't know how to approach the feedback and take action upon it, it will fail on the long run. And the last one is the deliverable. This is all about standardizing the data and building metrics upon it. Once you can build the metrics, you can show the value in threat intelligence. So I'll go through each step, and I'll explain the elements that it has to deliver the results of each step. So usually with the threat intel frameworks that we have nowadays, it's just high-level steps. We took a little different approach here, so we are going in details for each step and explain how you can actually apply each of it, so you see value in threat intelligence. So the first one was the relevant. That is constructed from the threat profile and your threat intel program requirements. They'll give you the result of the relevant threat intelligence. The efficient one is probably what a data scientist will love. This is about the threat intel scoring and categorization to make sense of all that threat intel data that we have. Next step is the analyst driven. Here we have two elements. We have the feedback loop, and we add on top of it the machine learning component that is helping us easily understand all that feedback. And the last one is the standardized formats and metrics, as I mentioned, that is giving us a deliverable step. Okay, so to deep dive in each of these steps, I'll go element by element, explaining how we get to the actual results. So relevant threat intelligence, we're getting first, we should ask the question, from whom we are trying to defend. Just to give you an example, you're a small e-commerce company, you have just e-commerce website, and you won't go after nation state threat actors where the attack complexity is pretty high and takes all things complicated. You will go after organized crime or the scammers. On the other side, if you're oil company in Middle East, then you'll be way more concerned about the state-sponsored threat actors. The next one, really important, is the infrastructure that you're trying to defend. So to understand your the attack surface that you're exposing, because the threat intelligence data, it's not all the same based on the infrastructure that you try to defend. If you have payment systems, you'll be interested in credit card information, probably IPs from where a fraudulent payment might come. If you are interested, if you have just servers, then you will look specifically for file hashes, but not so much for URLs or emails, because sysadmins, they shouldn't browse from the server itself. The result of answering these two questions is giving you the relevant, which is giving you the feeds or sources from where you should consume threat intelligence. The other thing is that you might have a complex infrastructure where you might have all of these things within your network, and you might have multiple sectors that you need to try to protect from all of them. Then you'll need to try to segment it, because different infrastructure will be affected by different threat actors. Going into the threat intel program requirements, this is a unique maturity model that we've created. If you have been for a while in the threat intel field, probably you have seen many of those maturity models that different companies created, how you can take your threat intel program to the next step. Usually they have five, six, seven steps, which is making things complicated and hard to understand where you're standing and what your next step should be. So what we did, we analyzed multiple maturity models, and we simplified it into two simple stages. The early stage, that means that you're just starting to implement threat intelligence program, or in other words, maybe you're just starting to use the lead framework. And then is the mature stage, where you have clear understanding of everything, and you're trying to do more complex things like machine learning. This is the base of the maturity model, and it is depending on the use cases that you have. Threat intel usually starting with security operation, incident response, and it's completely okay to start there, because it's also easier to start from there. To reflect on that, we need mainly atomic, or what we call computed indicators. Those are the ones that, you know, IPs, domains, file hashes, URLs, email addresses, and so on. And the integration type, I'm saying automation. You cannot do threat intelligence without automation. You cannot make it useful if you have, let's say, Excel spreadsheet and you're adding that to your SIEM to detect something. On the other side, on the mature stage, we have, as consumers, threat hunting. We have the red team and non-standard threat intel consumers. I'll go into a little more details on the next slide to understand what that might look like, just to give you some idea. Here, because we are using it for threat hunting and red team, we are more interested on the behavioral indicator. We don't just look at IPs and domains. We want to understand how specific attack is working and how specific group is operating. And because things are getting complicated, you will need to apply orchestration. You'll have multiple automations that mainly they'll be concentrated around your understanding the feedback, and apply as well machine learning that will allow you automatically process all that feedback that you're getting and then apply it back to your data. To support the maturity model, we have the threat intel sources. As I said, we need to lower the cost and increase the value. So if you're just starting threat intelligence, don't go wild and buy all the threat intelligence feed that they're out there just because they're saying that they'll fix all your problems. Start with simply threat intel sharing groups, because threat intel is all about sharing. It shouldn't be a huge threat intel sharing group that you're joining. It can be just a small one that, you know, a few other people from other companies that you can agree to share threat intelligence. Really important. It's the internally generated threat intel. So it's important to spread the word around your organization, what you do with threat intelligence, and how others might help you. It can start with simply other people sending you threat intel reports that they've heard, that they received, or some interesting behavioral indicators that they've heard from someone. You can go to your firewalls, DDoS solutions, get the data from there, and analyze it. See who is actually attacking you at the moment. Then, when you're more mature and you have clear understanding of your requirements and what are the gaps that you need to fill with the threat intelligence data, then you can go at the paid feed. Of course, it will increase the cost, but it will help you to have more complex database and more stakeholders. The data structure. So from the sole beginning, we should concentrate on standardizing everything. I know that we did wrong on the threat intelligence on the long run, because there are so many out there that they think that they invented a better way to structure the data, but that doesn't really work, because in the end, we are all trying to solve the same thing. And if our data is not structured, if we cannot understand what the others they're trying to share, it will be useless. So data structure, it's really important to have it all the way through your threat intel program from the sole beginning. Just some examples that we have here is the STIX 2.0 structure, the MITRE ATT&CK framework. You can use the older cyber kill chain. And have a threat library. When I say threat library, it's not just to have a database where you'll store all your indicators. It's all about the relationships that you have between those indicators. You need to understand which indicator it's at the early stage of attack, which indicator it's used when it's later in attack for action and objectives, how they're related to specific malware families, how many malware kids they're using the specific indicator. So it's all about the relationship that is helping you understand your data, and you know exactly who can have use of it. Going back to the cost, as at early stage, you should concentrate mainly to not to be that expensive, in other words. So because you're using less resources, you don't invest a lot on threat intelligence feeds. And as you show value and you see that your threat intel program is effective, you can take it to the next stage where it's becoming a little more expensive. So going to the non-incident response threat intel consumers. This is something new, and that's why I put a separate slide to it, just to give you for some ideas how you can use threat intelligence outside of, let's say, your comfort zone, the SOC, the IR. If you have, let's say, payment system on your from your company, and you're handling all your payments, you can use threat intelligence for e-commerce to detect a fraud. You can have a database with compromised credit cards, IPs from where fraudulent payments are coming, and you can use it that way to protect yourself from fraudulent payments as well your customers in case they have compromised credit cards. The next one is code repositories and zero-day exploits. This is more for someone that would be concentrated on the software development, and or if you have like vulnerability management team and you're trying them to assist them. They are one of your stakeholders. How you can do it? You can search mainly code repositories to see for any exposed credentials. You can check for leaked code that was not supposed to be publicly exposed. When we are going about the vulnerabilities, you can use dark and deep web data to check what is the interest for a specific vulnerability and what are the chances that it might be created a zero-day exploit. So you can help the vulnerability management team better understand the risk and to know what to patch faster. Because, for example, they're getting, let's say, a feed from a vulnerability management company and is showing what is the current risk or how hard it's to exploit something specifically. But they don't show what is the interest for that specific exploit. The customer content moderation. So this one is interesting and unique. Let's say you have a forum or a community page where all your customers, they are asking for help, sharing some feedback for your products. It's all nice and good, and you wouldn't expect to be something malicious there. On the bad side, there are many scammers that they'll go on these forums or community websites, and they'll share phishing links to phish someone for, let's say, fake support, or just to phish them to a page where they can download specific plugin and install malware on their system. So it's an interesting use case where you can use threat intelligence and apply it. And the last one is the piracy. In case you're in that area, you can go like search for any pirated software or any customer compromised credentials. And so on. So these are just some examples. If you're using threat intelligence differently, I'll be really happy to hear after the talk and share some experience, because as I said, threat intelligence is all about sharing. If we have more use cases, we can help each other to prove the value of threat intelligence easier and faster. Okay, so going into the data analysis, making the threat intelligence efficient. There'll be some heavy content coming here. Probably the data scientists, they'll love it. So starting with the threat intel scoring. So how we see it, you need to better understand your data, you need to have some proper scoring metrics or algorithm in place. And it will all depend on your threat profile, as I mentioned earlier, depending on your infrastructure. Starting with the indicator types. For servers, you will rate higher IPs, domains, any C2 infrastructure, file hashes, file paths, where emails and URLs you'll rate way lower. So that will give you a better understanding what is important to you, what should be taken care of with higher priority, and as well reduce false positives. Going forward, we have the threat attribution. If you're a small company, and you're selling some, you're just a small e-commerce site, and you won't be rating anything state-sponsored really high, because the chances that they'll go after you, they'll be really low. Also, if you're not part of some supply chain, the chances are even lower. So you don't want to put a lot of effort on data that won't actually be relevant to you. On the other side, you'll be highly interested on ransomware and crypto miners that may affect you. The threat intel data source is pretty big one, because it's showing you how much you can trust the specific source from where the data is coming. With open source, the idea is really good. Share with everyone anything that you want, but that data, it's not vetted, it's not confirmed. Anyone can share IP and say, I've seen this malicious or suspicious, but if you throw it in your environment, it might not be relevant, and will create a lot of false positives. On the other side, the threat intel sharing groups, I said, bigger threat intel sharing groups that they grew over the years just for the sake of sharing, where a lot of companies, they're just participating and they're hoping that someone will send them the latest attack. That doesn't happen. On the other side, smaller groups that you might have, they'll be way more valuable and you'll rate them, the data coming from those, you'll rate it higher. The paid feeds, if you don't rate higher the paid feeds, then you did it wrong. I mean, you're spending money for something that doesn't have a lot of value for you. So paid feeds together with the internal source threat intelligence, they should be usually highly rated or scored. Earlier we mentioned that one of the big problems that we have with the data is the retention period. So we don't know currently what is happening. If the data is new, you alert on it. But if the data is older, you just, or you ignore it, or you keep it in your system forever and it's keeping false positives. In this framework, what we have is to apply it within the scoring. So anything that is coming newer and is related to newer attack doesn't mean that you received it now and it was from 1 week ago. But you need to understand when the actual intel was extracted. Increase the scoring on anything that is newer and reduce it on anything that is older. That way, the older data, you can use it informational, like historical, to better understand how previous attack was working, where on the new data, you will actually alert and take action upon it. The most important one, I would say, is the context. So probably you have seen on many talks and white papers that we have for threat intelligence, it's been a while. If you don't have context about your data, it's not actually a threat intelligence because you don't know what's behind it. Why I'm saying that it's really important and can actually help you. This is a key element to understand how to categorize it for your stakeholders. Let's say the targeted operating system. You have all Linux environment. Why would you send all the Windows malware indicators? It's a high chance that it will generate false positive. On the other side, it will just overwhelm the stakeholders with data that is not relevant for them. The targeted region and sector is another interesting thing, and it's another thing that we have there, the location-based visibility is one of the big problems. So if we know that the threat actor or specific malware family is operating in a specific region, let's say it's operating in Asia and you're located in Europe, you won't rate it higher because the chances of seeing it in your environment are really low. And again, we are going back to the thing that it might just overwhelm your stakeholders with data that is not relevant. The MITRE ATT&CK framework and cyber kill chain, they're hard to add them as a context and not a lot of threat intelligence. It really has it. It's something that it started recently, but if you have it, you can go back to the infrastructure. For example, the infrastructure that is publicly exposed, you will use the threat intelligence that is related to reconnaissance attacks, because that's where you will see most of them. You won't see inside of your network reconnaissance attacks coming from externally. And it's the same way. If you have like locked down servers, you will concentrate on action and objectives related indicators because that's from where they might extract some data. Then we are going to categorize all this data. Once we properly score it and understand the risk and what is important and not that important for us, we split it in separate categories. The categories, they should be based on your stakeholders. Each use case that you have, it will have, you should put it in a different category. That way you'll send the proper data to them. The other thing that you can use for categories, it can be simply to split it into historical data and actionable data. So the historical, you're using it whenever you're doing IR analysis and you just want to understand how specific threat actor was working, operating in the past. but you don't want specifically to alert on it, because most likely they change their infrastructure nowadays. So it will be mainly that you're interested in the TTPs, so the techniques and tactics and procedures that the threat actors they're using. We're going to the into more details on the feedback loop. To better understand how a feedback loop is working, I'm starting here with the usual threat intelligence infrastructure or architecture, let's say. On one side, we have all the threat intelligence feeds where they're feeding into your threat intelligence platform, where you apply all the context so you understand the data so you can properly score it and categorize it. Then we are using the automation to send it to our stakeholders. Once they have it in the data, they want to provide you feedback how useful was that data for them. I'm saying that we are using orchestration here because you'll have multiple automations. The feedback, whole feedback process is getting a little more complicated. On the other side, going and analyzing like for three years feedback from different stakeholders, we came up with this structure. So the feedback usually it will be true positive or false positive. The false positive it's a tricky one. Many they'll say, okay, it's false positive, I won't use it anymore, I'll keep it as a false positive in my database, I'll just simply remove it. But that's not all the time the case, especially when you have multiple stakeholders. It might be false positive for one stakeholder that is showing you that the data that you send them, it's not that relevant, so you just take it out for them. On the other side, if they're all the stakeholders that you have saying that it's false positive, then you can simply remove it. On the true positive side, we have two things. One is, was the context that you send a matching or not? A simple example on this one is, you have indicators related to ransomware, and you send it to your SOC team. They analyze the attack, they did a great report, and they're saying that, yes, it was true positive. But we detected a crypto miner, so it's not anymore part of the ransomware malware family. That means that the context, it didn't match. So you need to update the context, take all that feedback, and then apply it back to your scoring categorization to know if it's still relevant to you. Maybe ransomware is not that interesting, but crypto miners, they're interested because you have a lot of IoT and servers in your environment. Using, sending back your feedback and applying again the scoring and categorization is helping you to create dynamic threat intel database. And to help us with all this feedback that we have, here it comes into play the machine learning portion. Something that we tried and it works really well with analyzing the feedback. It's using natural language processing. Just an example, we have a huge report where, as I mentioned, the analysts, they wrote how now the indicators for the crypto miners, now they're ransomware. It won't be just a simple like two lines that you can parse them and apply the new scoring. On the other side, you can use the natural language processing, analyze all those reports, extract your keywords, and create statistical model that will show you what is the change. So it was used previously as crypto miner, now it changed because in the report we are seeing a lot of ransomware. That means that there's a new context. You extract those keywords, and then you throw them back to your scoring and categorization model. And based on your new keywords that they're added as attributes in this case or context, you'll kick again the scoring process and reevaluate your data. On the other side, for the machine learning, this is one of the use cases that you can apply it. But there is more to it. So as I said, this is making your threat intelligence database dynamic. On the other side, it can help you as well to analyze better the tactics and techniques used by specific threat actors. So there are some interesting open source projects that you can see where they're going through all the open source reports for specific threat actors. They're analyzing using, again, natural language processing. They're extracting keywords, and they're seeing what are the techniques that they're recently using and how they're matching with other groups. Or simply just use it for data mining to extract additional threat intelligence. We're going to the last section here, where it's the deliverable. As I said, the standardized format, it's a key element. When we are about talking about threat intelligence, you should expose all your database through APIs. So everything that you know about your data should be available through the API. So any stakeholder can access it anytime, and they can take action upon it. Because if you have a ton of context, but your stakeholders, they cannot access it, it won't be useful for them. You'll leave them in the dark. We said about the STIGS 2.0 structure. It's a nice way to structurize your data, and it's easily to make sense of it. So if you are talking all about standardizing data, it's one of the standards that we are preferring over others. And the last one, the metrics. So this is making value of your threat intelligence. It's not anything unique that we have at metrics. If you have seen the talks in the last year for threat intelligence, really high percentage of them, they concentrate on how you can build metrics of threat intelligence. So our framework is not reinventing something that many people already talked, but it's just pointing out what has been mentioned, how you can build the good metrics based on three simple rules. First, don't make them actor-driven. That means don't rely that you'll win the jackpot and you'll get the next state-sponsored threat actor in your environment. That will happen once, but it might not happen for 2-3 years. How you'll show value of your threat intelligence program if you're just relying that you'll detect something big. On the other side, you should concentrate on how and where you're using threat intelligence. Concentrate on how many stakeholders you have, how they use that threat intelligence data, how it helped them to stay safer. And the last one is pick your audience. You serve specifically just the SOC team. So you'll want to build a lot of tactical threat intel reporting. Well, it will explain specifically how a malware family is working. It will go the same for the threat hunting team. On the other side, when you're going on higher level, you will want to use all the nice stats and dashboards where it will show over time how you progressed, how many stakeholders you added, how it increased your threat intelligence database, how you score it based on the threat profile that you have. And on the strategic one, it will show what is your threat landscape. So how you're comparing with other peers. Have you seen more attacks than they have been for the specific sector that you are? And with this one, I'll jump into the, I'll say, key takeaways or the apply slide. Just to summarize, the threat intelligence program, it's all about understanding what are your needs. So first thing that you can do even from tomorrow, go at the threat profile. Understand, even if you're doing threat intelligence, see if you're doing it right. Understand if the data that you have is coming from it's related to the threat actors that they might go after you. And the next thing is just promote threat intelligence within your organization. Like that, many people, they'll be aware what you're doing. And as well, you will get new sources of threat intelligence or even stakeholders that they might use. Further than that, it will be to set up your requirements. So set up goals where you're heading next. How you can use the maturity model to set goals for your threat intelligence program or just start it from scratch. On the data portion, I would say it's definitely interesting, but it takes time. Data, you don't simply apply the scoring once, and after 2 months you're saying, okay, this is the model that I have, this is the algorithm that I've created, and it's all working. It may take even a year to understand completely the data that you have and to fine-tune it until there is the amount of false positive, it's really low, and the stakeholders, they're really happy with what you provide, so you provide accurate and relevant data. And the metrics that are coming in the end. When you're sure that you're doing something, you can start building metrics. On the other side, it's key to build metrics all the way as you're building your threat intelligence program, so you shouldn't share them like high level from the beginning, but it will show you how you're performing. Do you do the threat intel program right or wrong? And with that one, I'll leave it for some questions. Yes. It's one question. Thank you.
Is there a particular threat intelligence maturity model that you prefer you guys use?
Sorry?
Is there a particular threat intelligence maturity model that you prefer or use?
So, I mean, it's the maturity model that we've created because it's combining multiple ones and it's simplified. But outside of that one, I don't have any because none of them is actually actionable and you can go after it and build a threat intelligence program. It's just really high level and not showing you what you should do next. So I don't think that the amount of the paid feeds is justifying the relevant data that you have. It might be one single paid feed because you have a use case just for the data that they have. It might be five different feeds if you, as I said, if your organization is through multiple sectors, if the infrastructure is really complex, then definitely you'll need more feeds because you try to cover more. Also, it's depending on the stakeholders that you have. If it's just the SOC, I don't think so you'll need dark and deep web intelligence that much, and you'll go after those feeds where you'll specifically concentrate on whatever it's like server, endpoint infrastructure, and so on. Sorry? So first thing, it's really important to pick the right threat intel database or repository because that's where everything it will go. What you should consider, I mean, I don't have any preference because if I say something, it will be relevant to our infrastructure, but it might not be relevant to you. So pick the one that it has really flexible API, and the second where you can apply the custom scoring. There'll be many threat intelligence platforms that they'll be, okay, you get all the data and we'll do the magic behind and we'll apply the scoring, but it won't be really relevant to you. So if you consider just the flexible API and the scoring, you should find the one. I don't have any preference to the specific one. Other questions? Yes. So yes, I mean, how it's made, as I said, if you have the flexible API, you can feed it to any SIEM that you have. Or if you have like orchestration platform, it will depend on the on the API that you have, because the orchestration platforms, they're all based on if they can communicate with API or not. So I mean, as orchestration platforms, the ones that they're doing, I don't know, great job, as I know, it's one from the Phantom, Demisto, and it's one also that is open source. I don't recall exactly the name, but they can all, yes? Yes. So and you can use any of them as long as you have your repository exposed, it will be really easy to implement it. Of course, it will be a lot of engineering work, but the threat intelligence what I've seen through the years, it's nothing is working like out of the box, because when you create your threat intel data, it will be unique to what you have. And it's really hard to say, yeah, I have the solution and I have all the scripts that you need and you can run it right away. You'll need to do a lot of customizations and build your own scripts that will be specific to the data set that you have. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, so as I said, if you try to first to see all the context that you have, made a statistical model on all the attributes that are related to your IOCs, and then try to apply some scoring on whatever it's relevant. First thing, you can go just whatever it's new and old. See whatever you got in the last 3 months and concentrate on that one if your database is too big and you have too many IOCs. And then gradually go through the older data to make sense, because the one that is newer, it's more actionable and you want to profit from that, I would say, and use it way faster. As I said, yes. Check from where it's coming, the source. If the source it was saying it was the attack in the last, I don't know, 1 month or two, rely on that. But if the source doesn't specify when it was used, leave it for later. So the ones that it's confirmed, it's way better to take action on it and not to risk it. Other questions? OK, thank you, everyone.